Publicly, the two main reasons that they gave for wanting to interrupt the process were, number one, they complained that there was a lack of outreach. Like I see this over and over again in big materials, like, we didn't know there was going to be an election until yesterday, or nobody told us there was going to be an election, we didn't hear about it, so it's not fair. And the other complaint that I heard a lot, or I see a lot and saw a lot in records, was that it wasn't fair to have just one polling place for the election that was only open for 4 hours. Those were the public themes that BIDS used to argue against letting the process go forward. Yeah.
But they don't want to force Diane and Betty like that.
I think that's true.
Think about that. Now they're trying to, that's bullshit, that's foul.
Okay. In some private emails that I got from the Public Records Act, I saw big people, especially property owners, complaining about what a Skid Row neighborhood council would do to their property values. That was another complaint that they had, although I think that they're wise enough in the ways of politics that they didn't make that argument publicly. The city's reaction to the complaint about inadequate notification and request that the election be postponed was to say no. Jose, I wish I had time to play this whole clip from the Rules and Elections Committee meeting where Jose Huizar decided what was going to be done with the election. He coaxed Gracie Liu into telling him that there was no legal way to postpone it, so he said, okay, fine, we won't postpone it. You guys win that part, you know? Like, everybody has to win something. The other thing that they wanted from to mitigate the so-called trouble with voting in one place for 4 hours, even though it turns out that's standard for all neighborhood council elections, was to have pop-up polling locations, many of which were actually in bid offices. The Fashion District had at least one that I know of. I don't know if you've been to the Fashion District offices, but
That's what it was all about. You talk about three or four somewhere else.
They were other places, yeah. I can barely get past the security to get into the Fashion District office myself. I'd like to see So as I'm sure you all know, Huizar accepted this argument, and he activated online voting for the Skid Row Neighborhood Council, and he activated multiple polling locations, which I think is what did
online voting,
especially the online. But I haven't seen a breakdown of the in-person votes by polling place, because it's people, like, who else is going up to the ninth floor of that building of the Fashion District to vote, except for a bunch of Fashion District?
Are there donuts?
What?
Are there donuts?
Yeah, all of them.
You're probably $100 checks made out to Jose Huizar that you could pick up. If you got that PDF, it's got an incredible amount of detail of the process of BIDS lobbying against the neighborhood council. I'm sorry, I'm feeling bad about pain tonight. I don't want to talk about it too much, but let me just hit some highlights. On January 11th of this year, the Department of Neighborhood Empowerment approved the petition to have a Skid Row Neighborhood Council formation election. The very next day, hardly 24 hours later, Blair Beskin, the executive director of the Historic Core BID, emailed Jose Huizar's office and said that she and Stella Lopez and Michael Davigiani, who's a big property owner, wanted to meet with Huizar to discuss the Skid Row Neighborhood Council, which I think makes me skeptical about every single claim that there was inadequate notification, since she was making appointments to lobby Huizar about it one day after it started. In fact, one of her employees, Paula Flores, actually said in public on March 20th that she didn't have adequate notification. In any case.
I'm gonna
forego scrolling through them and showing you actually, but if you get that PDF, every single document. And the way the thing is written, every statement I make is linked to a PDF that shows you how I don't know that PDF. That's not true with the stuff, the general stuff about bids, that's too general. But everything about Skid Row Neighborhood Council is based on the actual documents.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Are there questions so far? Yes.
Where can we find it?
Oh, sorry, it's just for tonight only. I'll probably leave it up through tomorrow, but go to this website here and just click on it. There's four files, and one of them's a PDF, and just get that one. Also in January, Stella Lopez made public records act requests herself to the Department of Neighborhood Empowerment, asking for copies of all the signatures of everybody who signed a petition in support of the election. She asked for documentation of the process that the department used to verify those signatures. Yes.
Why would she want the signature of everybody that voted?
No, everybody who signed the petition to have an election.
Why would you want that? I mean, what's her business? What is that to her?
This is the only time that you're ever going to see me send this stuff over. But I think, okay, that's a public record. She has as much right to it as I do to the records that I get from her. I can't, okay. And I know she probably wants it for something bad, but it's like this fundamental principle of the laws of California is so important that everybody can get any record they want, no matter what they want to do with them. So even if she's going to sell them to Satan and our city after them, she has a way to have it. But I don't know what she did with them, but I think what she did with them is give them to Rocky Delgadillo, because he later showed up with a list of how many signatures were in ballot, and he had he submitted a list of signatures to the city. So I think that's what happened to that.
Which caused us to have to do the whole thing again.
The messages that were sent from Patty Berman's email to vote no, to vote against the Steve Romero, they didn't question that.
I don't know that. I just focus on
that. That was a big scandal, and it's in LA Times. Anybody can read it here. It's like she was claiming that somebody hacked her email and sent an email to everybody to vote no. That was a big scandal.
I went to that meeting, but it's so much work focusing on bids alone. I have to just, I could spread out. Okay, so in February, Estella Lopez was monitoring Skid Row meetings on the Skid Row Neighborhood Council, and by March, some still unknown opponents of the Neighborhood Council formed a limited liability corporation in Delaware and hired lobbyists to lobby against the Neighborhood Council. So I don't know how much of that actual event had to do with bids. My feeling is that there was something to do with it, because Estella Lopez, her name pops up everywhere, but I don't have any smoking gun. So I can't say for sure that that particular thing was bid related. I'm sorry. I'm just, I'm going to skip all the rest of the details here because there's two. Anyway, all this lobbying, bids are involved at every stage. There's the different meetings involved. There, sometimes close to 25% of the speakers were from bids. That was true at the Rules and Elections Committee meeting on March 22nd. 10 out of 44 speakers were either bid staff or on the bid board of directors. It didn't count for an earlier meeting of the Board of Neighborhood Commissioners, but there were tons of bid board and staff there as well. And as everybody knows, the ultimate result was that Jose Cuisar decided on his own, I think, without even missing any of his testimony, but I don't know for sure, but, to allow him to vote, and that was the final nail in the coffin. Jose Cuisar decided on his own to allow online voting in the Skid Row Neighborhood Council election, and that's why it lost. It was allowed for that election only, no Neighborhood Council before. Specifically, it says no Neighborhood Council after. I'm still speechless.
Your speech is, we're still numb from the result.
Okay, so just finish up. Let me just play, I want to play a couple audio clips. One is a comment made by Debbie Welsh, who was formerly on the Fashion District Bid Board of Directors at a public meeting. As she kind of exemplifies the different arguments that the bids used. So I want to pay her. And the last clip is Jose Cuisar himself making a recommendation on March 22nd. We have what upsets me, even almost as much as what he's saying in this clip, is the way you can tell from the clip that he's reading it off a piece of paper, so that the previous hour of public comment, obviously, you know, has to do with the decision making. So let me just play those, and then I'll just get questions from the panel.
They weren't notified. I'm also on the board of directors for.
Okay. Here we go.
This is on March 20th. At the Board of Neighborhood Commissioners.
Debbie Welch.
And I'm against the request for a April Neighborhood Council vote for April 6th. Due to the following. First of all, it's against my violation of contribution in the community, because that's who I am. I first saw something about it on a social media platform a little over a week ago, and I saw someone named General Jeff who was talking about it, and so I asked our local business improvement district, the historic core. They weren't notified. I'm also on the board of directors for the fashion district that we weren't notified as a board or a board member. So there's no notification. There's hearsay also that the member seats are already or mostly filled. So that, again, violates my rights to be able to vote or be on a council. I can't vote the normal way that I normally vote, like I do an absentee vote, because I have a normal work hour at 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Friday. So it's not solid or fair. This is not a fair notification of voting standards for our forefathers created, which again violates my ability and others' abilities to fairly contribute to their communities in a reasonable manner and a reasonable time. Thank you.
Wow. That was one to be a board member. And here, and just to close, on March 22nd, what he's doing in this speech is he's making a recommendation to the Rules and Elections Committee, which then recommends to the full council. So if you follow LA politics, you'll know that any issue that happens entirely within one council district, committees and the full council will almost always completely defer to the opinion of that council member. Okay, so when Rizar says, we want to have online voting, Kurt Wesson, who's the president of that particular committee, says, okay, we'll just do it by
acclamation,
right? And then it goes to the full council. In this case, amazingly, and I don't know the details, but Paul Kerkorian voted against it. So like, I haven't had time to listen to the council meeting yet to find out why that was. But it's a rare event. In any case, listen to Jose Guizar, and then this will be the last.
So with that, Mr. Chair, I think some people here have asked that we also postpone the election. As you've heard, we can't do that. Move it a few days, which I don't think you get the type of additional outreach that we would like to see by moving the election just a few days. But I would ask that we, my recommendation would be that the Department of Neighborhood Empowerment and the city clerk be instructed and authorized to enable the online voting platform for the April 2017 Neighborhood Council subdivision election for the downtown area. This should not change the existing suspension of online voting in any other area until we can further discuss the issues in the Dunn's report and the factors that led to the suspension. Two, I would further move that we continue the associate council file and recommendations listed in Dunn's report and committee for further discussion and evaluation. And three, to assist with that future discussion, I would like to instruct Dunn to report to this committee with a recap of online voting for the April 2017 subdivision elections, along with recommendations from that experience.
All right,
so
that's it. Yes, questions.
Well, I guess this is total speculation, but would you believe that that was a process of just various meetings, building some sort of consensus, and then maybe a staff member writing it up? Or, you know, was this something that wasn't even based on a series of meetings building consensus, but somebody like knew this even before there would be a need for a series of meetings to build consensus?
I have no way to tell. I don't have the evidence. My only feeling I have, as strong as I don't know if you can tell from that clip, but it seems to me that at some point in there he started reading from something.
Well, he did from the beginning. We were there.
Oh, you were there.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah.
That's
right.
That's so. Whatever the consensus was, it wasn't built through public comments at the meeting.
Oh,
no.
Oh, yeah.
Something
else. Yeah.
Yeah.
We were all shocked.
Yeah, he had already made his decision.
Right.
Yes.
But my question that I have is, I want to go back to what really to me is what you mentioned as the elephant in the room was a comment about what some of the bid property owners felt that Skid Row, quote, would do to their property values. I think that is at the heart of the whole deal. You know what I mean? Because Skid Row is predominantly black, has been, all the downtown historically has been. We understand that they want to change that makeup. But in the guise of all this rezoning, you know, I guess, you know, it's calling for what it is, you know what I mean? It's still happening as the whole redlining thing happened in the 40s. I mean, this is all part of that, I think. And that fact that we still have people who've been at the helm of these organizations for 20, 30 years or employed in the same position for 20, 25 years goes to say that it's, you know, the same as usual. That was what this whole performance was about, to show the collusion and how deals get made with city council members, backdoor deals, and how developers want specific areas, you know, for them. How to change that, you know, we're still fighting today to get recognized for what we want. We know that change is coming, but let us get something out of the deal. You know what I mean? That's what we're fighting for.
Or to have some input.
Or some general input that will be taken to heed and not just presentation about what they're going to do to our neighborhood. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, and I think it's more like redlining even than redlining is not just a metaphor here. Because I think that until 48 when racial covenants and deeds became unenforceable, commercial property in the city of Los Angeles was universally owned by white people. And not only that, when you have some commercial property and you die and you leave it to your children, they don't have to sell it to get the money, they just keep it, you know? So you see commercial property goes down in families in a way that residential property does not at all. So after Shelley B. Kramer in 48, it's slow, but it's happening. In another 50 years, 100 years, whatever, residential property may be, ownership may be segregated, I mean integrated, I don't know, but commercial property changes so much more slowly. So when the city of Los Angeles chooses to take property ownership, ownership of commercial property, and make it a prerequisite for applying to a bid, and then giving a bid a lot of political power. What they're doing is reproducing this kind of white ownership power that comes from property ownership before Shelley B. Kramer, they're bringing it into the modern era, like the actual ownership structures.
It's about gentrification.
It's worse than gentrification because like they never left. I read a comment from a community activist in Crenshaw, I can't remember where when they were in, but they were asking about how he felt about white people moving into his neighborhood and gentrification. He said they've been here all along because they own the whole city. And that's what they were
about.
Yeah. Sorry. I don't want to keep it.
So they just want it back.
I don't think they ever lost it. Yes.
Hi, my name is General Jeff. I'm the chair of the Skinner Neighborhood Council Formation Committee. On behalf of the Formation Committee, I want to say first and publicly thank you for taking an interest in our community's affairs as we are in efforts to improve where we live. I really appreciate you doing this presentation and opening up to all folks in downtown to find out more about who you are and what you do instead of you hiding behind in the computer. Two questions. One, what made you take an interest in the Skid Row Neighborhood Council when your focus is more on bids? That's the first question. And number two, do you think, based on your research and expertise, do you think there are grounds for a lawsuit moving forward? Thank you.
Okay, the second question I'm just not going to answer. I'm sorry. I have no idea about that. What made me take an interest is that somebody emailed me because of my calling and said, look at what these bids are doing for the Skid Row Neighborhood Council. Maybe you're interested in it. I don't know. So somebody tipped me off that there were bids active in the process, so I just got interested. Yes?
Have you spoken about bid in theory and in practice, but my question to you is, what does unifying the communities of downtown Skid Row and Hollywood look like, specifically in reference to our friends on the streets, homeless? What does your solution look like?
I don't have a solution. It takes all my energy and all my thought to identify problems. Solving them is a different thing. But I do remember that my fourth grade teacher told me that I complained about something to the hall passes of my that unless you have a solution, don't complain. And that trapped me for a long time, and I've since learned that it's okay to say that something's wrong without knowing how to fix it, and I don't know how to fix it, but it is wrong. Yes. Maybe everybody's cooking, and I'll be happy to hang around and take questions individually. Maybe people can be here if they want to. Thanks so much for coming.
Thank you.